Welcome to Smart News Digital, September 10, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is cloudy forecast on climate change. So what the news here is, in Bangkok last week, there held a conference of the United Nations Framework Convention on the climate change. So what is the purpose of this conference is to draft a rule book for the Paris Agreement. But the purpose is not getting done because it ran into a lot of difficulties over the issues of raising funds, majorly because of the unwillingness of the developed countries, which is led by US, to commit to the sound rules on raising the climate finance. So what is the news here is the developed countries led by US, that is under the Trump administration, they are unwilling to commit to raise the climate financing fund for the developing nations. Why they are stressed on the developed nations means because of the historical emissions of greenhouse gas emissions. The developed nations are actually more utilized the resources, burning the coal and the fuel in order to develop their citizens. So it is their responsibility to raise the climate funds for now to give those funds for the development towards the developing nations. So this Paris Agreement is adopted by 195 nations during the COP21, which is the Conference of Parties 21. And in that Paris Agreement, what the deal actually is, the rich countries has to raise $100 billion every year till 2020. And it make use of those funds in order to help the developing nations to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions globally, as well as to aid to floods, droughts and storms, which are the extreme events which is taken place in the developing nations. So we all knew that US is the second biggest polluter behind China. So the first major polluter is China and second one is the US. So the US, which is the developed nation, that should be the first nation that should come forward to raise the funds to help the developing nations. But they are the one who is actually restraining from raising those funds. So it is a major concern in the recent days. So first we have to understand what is the difference between the Paris Agreement and the Kyoto Protocol. Both these are the international agreement among the developed and the developing nations. Both are to combat the climate change by means of developed and the developing nations. So we have to understand what are the provisions under that or what are the aims of that so that we could differentiate between the two. So the first one is the Kyoto Protocol. It was actually made during the COP3 or Conference of Party 3 in the year 1997 itself, and it will lapse in 2020. So it will end in 2020. But this Paris Agreement is actually come into force by means of Conference of Parties 21. So it is COP3, it is COP21. In the year 2015, and it will come into force only by means of 2020. So it will end and it will start from there onwards. So it is a continuation of the Kyoto Protocol in order to combat the climate change. So in the Kyoto Protocol, there is a provision which actually ensures the penalty for not meeting the target of the emission control by the any nation, whether it is developed or developing. So any countries is coming under the ambit of the Kyoto Protocol and it should get the penalty if it is not meeting the emission targets. But under the Paris Agreement, there is no such provision for penalty. It is not that much stringent when compared to Kyoto Protocol. So in the Kyoto Protocol, there is a strict difference between the developed and the developing nation. It is putting more burden on the developed nation than the developing nation. It is giving lesser target to the developing nation and more target to the developed nation. So the developed nation is the one which is to ensure more emission reduction than the developing nation, because they actually already exhausted the resources which are available and they developed their citizens already. So it is now the time for the developing nations to make use of the coal, fuel or the resources to make their country more developed. So they have to provide the way for the developing nation. For that purpose only this Kyoto Protocol is being implemented. So it is majorly putting the burden on developed nation, as we said before. But this Paris Agreement, it is all nations equally, whether it is developed or developing, every country should equally share the burden. So every country which is nearly 55% of their total global emission, if it is there, then it should come under the ambit of this Paris Agreement and it should take the steps in order to reduce the GHG or the carbon emission, etc. So now we are going to see why the provisions under the Paris Agreement is very important, why every country should come forward and take the steps means. the losses which is caused by the weather events due to the global warming or due to the increase in temperature. So those losses is detrimental to not only to the developing nations economy, but also to the developed nations economy. It is detrimental to all economies. So we have to accept that and we should come forward. So already there are a lot of bad or detrimental events took place. The first one is the damage to the West Antarctic ice sheet due to the global warming or due to the increase in temperature is raising the sea levels. So it is a major concern. Second one is the 2-degree rise of the global temperature already destabilizes the Greenland ice sheet. So these two are the environmental aspects of the detrimental effects which is caused by means of this global warming. And also the failed agriculture, it is also driving more mass migrations of the people from the developing nations or from the infertile area to the fertile area. So this mass migration due to the failed agriculture is also causing a major detrimental effect to the economy of any country. So having said all these things as a negative aspect, we should make sure that we have to reduce the global emission by means of all the countries working in tandem. So we have already seen that historical emissions, right? So what are these historical emissions means? The emissions which are rising the standard or living standard of the citizen of a particular country. So already the developed nations like US, Britain, Germany, France, these developed countries, in those countries, they made use of the resources available to them and they raised the standard of living of the citizens of that country. But now, it is the time for the developing nations to make use of the similar resources to develop their nation. So they have to accept the more responsibility than the developing nation. This is what this historical emission stated, which means historically they emitted a lot. So now they should not emit than the developing nation. So if you see here, during the pre-industrial time, it is like 220 ppm of CO2 in the atmosphere, but now it is increased nearly to 410 parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It is mainly due to the accumulated CO2 due to the industrial activities carried by the developed nations as well as the developing nations, more due to the developed nations. So we all knew that as India and China are committed to the Paris Agreement, now it is their responsibility to act as a climate leadership in the developing world. So in the developing world, these two are the major countries, so they should come forward and take some steps. So what actually these developing countries need as of now is they need a supportive framework which binds the developed countries like US, France, Germany, Britain, etc. to their funding pledges. So before they actually accepted some funding pledges, right? So they should make sure that they are binding to that. And the support for the capacity building should be ensured to the developing nations. And the transfer of the green technologies liberally to the developing nations from the developed nations. So these are all the way forward to ensure the reduction of the GHG emissions as well as to ensure the climate stability. So the second article is bail over jail on due process. So we all knew that there are two things in polity. One is the due process of law, another one is the procedure established by law. Our country is following this procedure established by law. But what the content here is, if usually it is a procedure established by law, then any actions which is taken by any government authorities, it is just have to follow the procedures. So there are a certain set of procedures. So the authorities have to follow the certain set of procedures and they have to perform the functions. But if it is a due process, then they have to not only follow the procedure, but they also have to verify whether it is just and fair and whether it is rightful to the citizens or rightful to the any persons who are getting affected by that law. So what they are actually mentioning in this article is the arrest, custody or the remand actions which is carried out by the police, it should not be just simply a procedure established by law. It should rather than be a due process of the law. It should ensure the just and fairness. Whenever a police arrests a person, it should ensure the just and fairness and it should protect the dignity of that person. That is what they stated in this article. So we all knew that the section 41 of the CRPC, which is the Criminal Procedure Code, this section 41 ensures and empowers the police to arrest the people without warrants. But even though it stated without warrant, it puts some conditions to the police, like the offences which is by the person, it should not stimulate further offence, and it is tampering of evidences activities if it happens, or influencing of the witnesses. So these all things, if they are the consequences of that particular offence, then only you can arrest that person without any warrant. So that is what this section stated. So this power of arrest, which is conferred or given to the police, is employed with discretion and deliberation, which means the police should act with full discretion and deliberation. And they should not make use of this law as a tool of oppression or harassment. They should not use it for their personal vengeance, or they should not use it to suppress the people. They should use it deliberately. That is what they stated here. But so during the recent times, there are a lot of arrests and remands have taken place against the activists in order to suppress them or in order to oppress them, which is actually against the freedom of speech and expression, right? So for that, the Supreme Court stated that arrests should never be a reflexive response to an allegation of an offense. That means if a person is alleged to commit an offense, then you should not go there and immediately arrest that person. You should rather deliberately investigate what is the matter. Then only you should take the further steps. So this is what the Supreme Court states. So now we are going to see what are the recent and shocking arrests of activists. So the first one is the Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar case, in which this Arnesh Kumar is getting arrested under Dowry Prohibition Act. So for that, the Supreme Court stated that instead of ensuring the liberty of citizens, it is bringing humiliation and caste scars forever on the activists. This is what the Supreme Court stated. That means it is explicitly expressing its concern over the activities of the police. And the second major event is heavy-handed treatment by the police over an activist who is raising his voice over the Chennai-Salem 8-lane highway project. So this is also again oppressing that activist, right? So similarly, a student for raising political sloganeering on an airport, she is also getting arrested and remanded to 15 days judicial custody. So similarly, many activists are also getting arrested under alleged links to Maoist. So if they are this under this alleged link to Maoist means, then they are under the ambit of this Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, which is making the restrictions on bail. That means if any person is getting arrested under this Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, then it is become very stringent and it is become very hard to get the bail. So these are all the recent events which stated or which raises the concern over the activities of the police carried out over the citizens. So now we are going to see this Article 142 of the Constitution of India, which states that the Supreme Court has an extraordinary power, that is, in order to ensure complete justice in the territory of India, they can exercise its jurisdiction by means of passing orders in any case or matter which is pending before it, and that order or that decree which is passed by the Supreme Court to ensure the justice that is applicable or enforceable throughout the territory of India. So which means the Supreme Court has an extraordinary power to give the orders, or it can intervene into the activities of the government and it can put its order over the territory of India. This is what this Article 142 stated. So why it is means, then we can see in the next slide. So now what is the major concern here is there is always a dilemma in balancing between the individual liberty and the interest of the society. So balancing this individual liberty as well as the interest of the society is always a major question, because always this interest of society prevails over the individual liberty. So only they refuse the remand and grant the bail to the individuals, and they just continue to issue the orders mechanically, which means they just follow it everything in a procedure wise rather than ensuring the just and fairness for any activities which is carried out. So similarly, the police also doing this arrest, remand, everything procedurally rather than being justful. So what is the way forward here is the CRPC, which is the Criminal Procedure Code, what it is actually aiming is to protect the rights of the accused to the fullest possible extent, then substantial justice. That means the major aim is, first it has to protect the rights of the accused person, but at the same time it should ensure the substantial justice. It should do both the things simultaneously. And what here they stated is the police also need to follow the Supreme Court guidelines for casual arrests. So if it is a arrest, then it has to, that is the police has to follow the guidelines which is given by the Supreme Court. If it is missed that, then probably the Supreme Court is trying to invoke its extraordinary power under Article 142, which we have seen before. So the Supreme Court can now intervene and made some steps or put some new laws, which actually deteriorates the power of the police itself. So this is what they stated. So what the main aim here is to break the customary chain of arrest, custody and remand by the police. So for that, we have to, instead of just following the procedure thing, we have to follow the due process, which is we have to ensure the just and fairness in every activities which is carried out by any government authority, include the police. So the last article is why SEBI new norms spooked FPIs, which means why the new norms which is put forward by the SEBI, it is frightened the FPIs. So first major thing is, so the last article is why SEBI new norms spooked FPIs, which means why the norms which is put forward by the SEBI is frightened the FPIs. So in April, SEBI issued a circular which has know your customers and beneficiary ownership norms. So it has certain norms or the rules which should be followed by the investors. And it in that norm itself, they ask the category 2 and 3 FPIs to provide a list of their beneficial owners. So these new norms which is put forward by the SEBI, it is raising concern over the FPIs. And now those FPIs raising their concern, stating that if this norm by the SEBI, it is going to get implemented, then there could be a potential outflow of $75 billion from the Indian equity market. That is, whatever the money which is putting in our Indian economy by the foreigners, now it is going to get out from the Indian economy. That is what the FPI recently raised a concern about this norms. So first we have to understand what is the difference between FPI, FDI, then only we can easily understand this. So FDI means establishing a direct business interest in a foreign country by means of buying or establishing a manufacturing business. But FPI means investing in financial assets or the market assets such as stocks and bonds in a foreign country. So instead of occurring is different from purchasing. So FDI means occurring the thing, and FPI means purchasing a certain stake in that firm or the company, etc. So this FDI is a long-term interest in the economy of a foreign country, but FPI is a shorter time frame. It is majorly focuses on a profit. It actually wants to quickly realize the profit, or it wants to quickly get the profit by means of its investment. And it is higher level of investment. If you want to do FDI, you need more money, but for FPI you need lesser money. And so as it need more money, it is usually done by multinational companies and venture capital firms. But as it need very lesser money, it is more accessible to average persons itself, like you and me. Anyone can go and invest in the FPI. And in case of FDI, it is very difficult to liquidate or pull out from the investment. If you put money, then to withdraw the money, it is very difficult. But in FPI, the liquidity of FPI is very easy when compared to FDI. So because securities are very easily traded, so you can easily withdraw. That is what the major concern in the SEBI norms. That is, as FPIs are easily withdrawn, or it is very easily to liquidate the FPI, now the new norms by the SEBI, it triggers the FPI persons to withdraw from the Indian economy. So this is what the major recent concern is. And this FDI is business profitable and operate indefinitely. It is for a longer period of time, as we said before. And FPI is doesn't, as we said before, as it is only occurring a percent or a stake in a firm, it doesn't offer the control over the business entity. It doesn't give you the management authority, rather it give you some kind of ownership. That is it. So the news here is the resident Indians, NRIs, PIOs and the OICs, these people who are owning this FPIs or who are coming to India and putting the money in the FPIs or purchasing the stakes or bonds, anything in our country. So those people, what the SEBI stated is they could not be the beneficial owner of the fund which are they are investing in India. This is the first thing. And the second one is it is also pushing a threshold for the beneficial owner, like 15%, 25%. And if it in case of high risk nation, like if it is a nation with high money laundering activities or terrorism activities, then it is further reduced to 10%. So these are all the concerns for FPI persons. So these all led to the foreign funds which is managed or owned by the NRIs and PIOs may face difficulties, which means they now restrain to put the money in the Indian economy, and whoever already put their money in the Indian economy, they are now trying to withdraw. That is only nearly estimated like $75 billion by the FPIs. So now we are going to see why FPIs. So this foreign portfolio investment, they are the major investors in the Indian stock market, and the foreign funds are majorly holding by NRIs, PIOs, OCIs, and these people who are having the majority holding in the Indian stock market now, due to this SEBI norms, that means the SEBI stated that that means this NRIs, PIOs, OCIs, you are not the owners or you are not the beneficial owners, right? So in order to avoid the beneficial ownership breach, now they are looking for some alternative option or alternative structure. Instead of investing in Indian economy, now they focus towards some other economy which could provide them the beneficial ownership. So this is also a major concern. And so why SEBI is doing this? What is the motive behind this SEBI norms is in order to curb the money laundering and in order to curb the round tripping. So round tripping means if you are going to invest some money, that means if you are having money and now you are going to invest your money in some foreign countries like Mauritius or Singapore and you started a company there itself, and from there now you are again coming back to India through this FPI. Why? Because in order to evade the tax or in order to reduce the tax. Similarly, the black money also circulating like this only. Why FPIs are unhappy? So because of this SEBI norms, now FPIs is raising their concerns, right? So why? That means FPIs are currently allowed to invest up to 10% in a listed Indian company. So this is what before. But now the new norm, what it stated is the investment is limited or it will be clubbed if the FPIs have the same beneficial ownership. So this is the first concern. Second one is an entity owning a majority stake in a fund is considered as a beneficial owner before. So if you have majority of the stake, then you are the owner before. But now it is changed to whoever having both the shareholding and the control, they are now considered as a beneficial owner. So this is also a concern because the Indian origin fund managers usually don't own any controlling stakes. So this is again become or make the structure impermissible or impenetrable for the owners in order to become a beneficial owner. So the next concern is high risk nations which is affected by money laundering or terrorism activities. For those nations, this KYC norms are even more stringent, which means making or doing FPI in those high risk nations is now becoming very harder. And the last major concern is India-based investment managers, that means India-based investors, they usually set up overseas or offshore fund to attract the NRI money. So they are establishing companies mostly in the foreign nations only. So again, if they want to come and invest in India, then they have to come through that company only as NRIs or OCIs, etc. But this new norm is no longer be beneficial for the Indian-based investors. So these are all the concerns which is expressed by the FPIs towards the SEBI norms. So as a way forward, what the SEBI is now doing is they constitute a panel in order to get the public comments over this FPIs, and they will finalize soon.